Breaking live at BC Place in Vancouver. It's quiet right now. In 2 hours' time, the Dome will come alive with all the excitement of the 75th Grey Cup game. Join us on CBC Sports for 5.5 hours of Grey Cup coverage. But first, come with me as I embark on a memorable trip back in time. Well, I knew it wasn't a mistake to rent this car. It worked. This thing is amazing. Wonder what year I'm in. A paper. Let's check it out. U of T to meet Parkdale in first Grey Cup game. Looks like I'm back in 1909. Hey, that's the U of T. Good luck, guys. But as it turned out, U of T had luck on its side. They beat Parkdale handily, 26-6. Well, got a dash. We don't want to be caught in 1909 because there are lots more Grey Cups to see.
Some people still remember this year. It's 1946 and the Argonauts beat Winnipeg at home, 28-6. This is Vancouver in 1955 and Johnny Bright led the Eskimos to a win over Montreal. For Grey Cup oddities, nothing matches this year. It's 1962, and the Fog Bowl took 2 days to play. Winnipeg beat Hamilton by a single point.
I've got time for one more stop. I want to see my hero, Ron Lancaster, in 1966. This will be a great day for Ron Lancaster. He's going to be named the game's most valuable player. Hey, there's Don Whitman up in the booth. He hasn't changed a bit. Well, only 15 seconds more. I better get going.
Leon McQuay's fumble in 1971. The Argos were denied again, and Calgary won.
Whoa!
8, 7.
Tim, where's Scott?
5 to the left.
Hurry him in.
3, 2.
And cue Scott.
Welcome to CBC's Grey Cup Countdown.
The following is a CBC Sports presentation.
It was 1 week ago today, Gil Renfrow to Darryl Smith, putting Toronto in a position for the major upset in Winnipeg in the Eastern Final. Meanwhile, out here in Vancouver, later in the day, Edmonton using the long ball as well. Matt Dunnigan to Stefan Jones with the 80-yard game-breaker. And that set the stage for this afternoon. The Argonauts and the Eskimos for the 75th Grey Cup title. We are live from under the dome at beautiful BC Play Stadium. Western sunshine, and it is Grey Cup Countdown 87. And as we bring you inside under the dome, the respective dressing rooms, the Eastern champions on the left, the Western champions on the right. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Brian Williams. Welcome to the West Coast and Grey Cup 87. We are with you for 5.5 hours as we wrap up this season. Now, for the next 90 minutes, our countdown show will focus on the many aspects of this great Canadian tradition. Once again, we'll have our music videos, a somewhat different and whimsical look at Canadian football. We, of course, will be hearing from some of the many heroes of Grey Cup's past 75 history-filled years. And of course, being live here in the stadium is just after 12:30 on the West Coast. We will show you the teams as they come out to loosen up, the fans as they file in from the sunshine, the coaches, the players, and a whole lot more. In short, we are going to capture for you today the atmosphere here in the stadium right now. In fact, let's take you down to the floor of BC Play Stadium and on this Sunday say good afternoon to Steve Armitage.
Ryan, this has been a typically busy Grey Cup week here in Vancouver, starting with the kickoff party right through to the crowning of Miss Grey Cup. We'll show you all the highlights. You'll meet two key members of the Edmonton Eskimos, their outstanding middle linebacker Danny Bass and Mr. Excitement himself, one of the most exciting players in the CFL today, the one they call the Gizmo, the kick return specialist Gizmo Williams. We'll also be talking live to two members of the Eskimos, their coach Joe Farragelli and their quarterback Matt Dunnigan. I'll be busy, and so will Scott Oak. Scott? Steve, a funny thing happened to the Argos in the midst of what was supposed to be another rebuilding year for them. The Argos have decided to start at the top, and as a result of 8 wins in their last 9 games, they find themselves in the 75th Grey Cup game. A number of players have been critical to the Argos' success, among them slot back Darryl Smith, and we'll profile him on our Grey Cup countdown show. The Argos have unwavering faith in the ability of Lance Chumnik to put points on the board. We will also profile the Argos' place kicker. And coming up on Countdown, I'll be talking to Commissioner Doug Mitchell about a difficult season. Brian?
All right, Scott, a couple of years ago, in fact, I think it was in Montreal, CBC's Grey Cup Countdown program introduced to you Canadian Football League videos. Now, these are actions and reactions from life on the football field set to music. Then, as well as now, the portrayal of high-speed collisions equals a smash entertainment hit. It is quite simply a fact of life in the CFL that only the strong survive. Our quote-unquote first smash hit of the day. More from our video files during the next 90 minutes. Up next, it is Confrontation 87, the head-to-head meetings between the Argonauts and the Edmonton Eskimos, and we will profile Grey Cup week in Vancouver. Stay with us. We are live from the West Coast. The Eskimos prepare in their dressing room.
I have one thing to say about this Christmas list.
What's that, Ruth?
Help!
Don't worry, we have that. And Jenny's coffee maker.
And for the workshop, we've cut the prices on 2 handyman saws. And they start at just $199.99.
Amazing. You covered the whole list. Santa, you really do bring home Christmas.
Home hardware.
In a big way.
Home handyman.
Santa's 900 helpers.
Hi, friends. Larry here from Trent Toyota. It's demo time. And in addition to the $1,500 minimum trade allowance, Trent Toyota is giving $500 cash back on all 1987 Toyota demos. Come on down to Trent Toyota and take advantage of these fabulous demo savings. $1,500 minimum trade, $500 cash back. That's at Trent Toyota, Tecumseh and Parent. What a place.
best selection of Waterford stemware, fancies, and chandeliers. Visit their new exclusive Royal Dalton, Waterford, and Noritake rooms featuring one of the largest selections of Royal Dalton in North America. Meet consultant Julie Gibb. Shanfield's Myers offers savings on flatware in gold, silver plate, sterling, and stainless. Their selection of Waterford crystal stemware, fancies, lamps, and chandeliers is one of the best. Shanfield's Myers, 188 Willette, downtown Windsor. Top premium paid on U.S. funds.
Hello, my name is Jerry Pouget. I'm proud to be a million-dollar producer with the Peddler People, as well as a very active volunteer within our community. I care, which makes the big difference in all your real estate needs. Whether you are buying or selling, my goal is to make you comfortable with all your transactions. Please call, and I'll be happy to meet with you and your family and help make your dreams come true.
Perhaps the CFL's greatest quarterback ever, Russ Jackson, won 7 Shenley Awards with the Ottawa Rough Riders, leading his team to 3 Grey Cup victories, including 1 in the final game of his career.
If I pick my greatest thrill, it would be the winning the 69 Grey Cup, which was the back-to-back one, and I was retiring with my last game, and that had to be one of the biggest thrills.
Jackson turned down a Rhodes Scholarship offer to remain in Canada, but still managed to develop his off-field interests even while starring as a football player.
I enjoy education. I enjoy working with young adults. I always have, and who knows how many more years I'll spend in education, but I'll finish my career, whatever it is, in terms of work as a principal of a high school in Peel, and I'm very pleased with it.
In his last game, Russ Jackson set a Grey Cup record on 4 touchdown passes.
Russ Jackson, who attended Westdale High School and McMaster University in Hamilton, the legendary Jackson continued his relationships with the Canadian Football League, first as a CBC commentator as well as head coach of the Toronto Argonauts. Now, the current Argonauts are meeting the Edmonton Eskimos for only the 4th time in Canadian Football League history. Toronto won the first 2 meetings back in 1921 and 1952. The one I remember in the rain, Edmonton taking the latest in 1982 at Exhibition Stadium in Toronto. Now let's have a look at how these teams fared against each other in the 1987 campaign.
Edmonton draws first blood. Matt Dunnigan handing off to Milson Jones. Powers into the end zone from 4 out. There's that quick 7-0 Edmonton lead. Now, still in the first quarter, Benardy evens the count. Third down dive, one of his 12 scoring runs on the year. Late third quarter, tied at 10. Chomak is good from 36 yards out. The Argonauts are on top by 3. They stretch their lead in the fourth quarter. Here's Kenny Joyner hauling in the pass from Gilbert Renfro. Joyner with 4 touchdowns before the season ending injury. With less than a minute to play, Allen floats a pass to Brian Kelly. 46-yard touchdown. Kelly's record-breaking 89th career touchdown reception, but it's not enough. Toronto hangs on for a 3-point victory. A little over 1 month later, we move to Edmonton. The Argonauts are introduced to Henry Gizmo Williams. He runs back this Hank Olisek punt, 86 yards in that usual waterbug style. The major breaks a 3-3 tie. One of 4 punt returns for touchdowns on the year for Williams, establishing a Canadian football single-season record. Love it in Edmonton. Second quarter, Damon Allen good for 12 yards to Marco Sinkar. The Eskimos lead 20-3. Points continue to pile up in Edmonton's favor in the third quarter. Toronto is held to a field goal. Blake Marshall's 4-yard score, one of Edmonton's 2 majors in that third quarter. Now facing a third and goal deep in Edmonton territory, Danny Barrett will elude the Eskimo rush. Toronto keeping its comeback hopes alive, now trailing by 15. 5-20. However, late in the final quarter, the Eskimos erasing all doubts about the outcome. Chris Skinner latching on to the Allen pass, finding the end zone. Eskimos get revenge and then some, stinging the Argos 42-20.
That Eskimo victory back in September the 12th, Edmonton favored by as many as 7 points in some quarters for this game, but remember, and I don't have to remind you Edmonton fans or the people in Hamilton, they were favored over the Ticats last year, and it didn't help against a fired-up Al Bruno team. Right now, let's take you back down to field level and once again check in with Steve Armitage.
Brian, perhaps the only place not inundated with Grey Cup activity this past week are the sidelines here at BC Place Stadium, but that's about to change. Outside of BC Place Stadium, the city of Vancouver has done a bang-up job in hosting a week full of Grey Cup festivities. Once the week's most important ingredient arrives, the players, a chain reaction of momentum begins to build in the Grey Cup city. Officially, the first function is the kickoff party. The past 2 years, the Commodore Ballroom has hosted this curtain raiser, which always manages to get everyone started on a fun-filled note. There she goes. Among the formal events, the Shenleys, with an Academy Award-style presentation, an evening of drama and emotion.
Tom Clements.
When you won the Rookie of the Year award, did you think you'd be around to win the Most Outstanding Player?
Not 13 years later, no, because in my rookie year, my thought was basically to play two or three years and call it quits, go to law school full time, and just become a lawyer.
Many of the same elements are displayed at the Miss Grey Cup pageant, a sparkling evening, especially for the regal winner, Laura May Laird, a BC native. At the convention center, thousands had fun at the Grey Cup extravaganza, Canada's largest football party. Headline entertainment, great food, music, and dancing. 40 years ago, a small band of Westerners staged an impromptu parade in Toronto. Yesterday's parade provided great family fun from English Bay to downtown Vancouver. Black tie dress was optional, but popular at the convention center, the 38th annual Grey Cup dinner, featuring Alan Thicke and Luba, a fitting prelude to the 75th Grey Cup game.
A lot of happy people taking part in festivities all around the city this week. Our next video suggests that football is not really a life and death affair. You've got to be ready to hang in there for both the good times and the bad. Huey Lewis's song puts the accent on a happy.
We've had some fun. Yes, we've had our ups and downs. Been down that rocky road. But here we are still around. We thought
yes, it has been an up-and-down season for all those involved with the CFL, and nobody knows it better than Commissioner Doug Mitchell. Commissioner, have you felt as though you've been under siege at times this year?
Well, not really. I don't think, Scott, you set your goals and objectives. I think you know where you start and where you want to end up, and you pursue it and let the chips fall where they may.
The league had to be a little bit concerned about the atmosphere surrounding this Grey Cup week, that it could have taken on the look of a death watch. Have you been happy with the atmosphere as it's turned out in Grey Cup week in Vancouver?
I think it's been absolutely superb. You know, the city of Vancouver and their festival committee of 1,000 volunteers have been an outstanding job. The Grey Cup pageant, I think, had a record number. The dinner was sold out. We had a party on Friday night, which was really dedicated to young people, and they had 8,000 show up at the convention center. So I'd have to say that everything that's been held this week in Vancouver has been an outstanding success.
One of the outstanding pieces of this has been the TV money that teams are going to get. Has that been finalized yet? Do you know the amount?
Well, we have a pretty good indication of where we are on it. It's not finalized yet until all the accounting has been done, but certainly we know pretty well where we are on it.
Can you tell us how much?
Sure, we're going to be around the $310,000 to $325,000 per club.
You had a major press conference on Wednesday to announce some major alterations to rosters and budgets. Have you any other major alterations planned for the offseason?
Well, Scott, I think one of the things that we wanted to do, we wanted to come into the Grey Cup weekend on the basis that everything was in order for the 1988 season. The Ottawa Rough Riders are going to be part of the Canadian Football League, not only for 1988, but they've given us their long-term plan for the league. We set our operating budget for the 1988 season for all the football clubs, and quite honestly, we feel that we're one of the first professional leagues in North America to address the financial limitations that we're dealing with. And everything's a go situation for 1988, and the clubs can start selling their season tickets on Monday.
All right, Commissioner, thanks for being with us on Grey Cup Countdown. We appreciate it.
Pleasure. Thanks, Scott.
Brian?
All right, Scott Oak, let's hope that preparations are a lot better for next year than they were for this year. If that is the case, the Canadian Football League will be in good shape. We'll take a look at the stands in just a minute. There we go. The fans are starting to trickle in. Both teams coming out on the field. Up next, the Eskimos' road to the Cup. A look at the weather and the game, and we will profile Argonaut place kicker Lance Chomick. Stay with us. A minute 39 to kick off for Grey Cup 87.
CBC Television.
You red-headed snippet.
Anne is back, and she's all grown up, leaving her girlhood behind.
Please say yes.
I can't.
Leaving Green Gables for a new life.
I understand you have extraordinary talents. I look forward to observing them.
A two-part movie special begins Sunday, December 6th, brought to you in part by Hall's Mentholictus. Monday night.
Men are my favorite subject. He was one of those guys who's only interested in one thing, himself.
Kate and Allie, then Degrassi Junior High.
Catch you later.
Rick's crazy about Caitlin. But what about her?
Why don't you just admit you like him? He's not my type. I'm just helping him, that's all.
Help me? What am I? A project or something?
Degrassi Junior High, Monday night, right after Kate and Allie over most stations.
You gave $275,000 to a man you met 8 weeks ago?
Yes.
When a smooth con artist takes a lonely widow for a ride.
This is a fight for justice. This is every man's fight.
I like that.
Street Legal. Best on the Box. Wednesday on CBC Television.
The search for Father Jim Carney. A journey that became a manhunt, then a crusade. Tuesday on Man Alive.
Contour chairs, made to measure furniture that's supposed to fit like a glove. But the company has legal problems and a lot of angry customers.
We went from frustration to irritation, then to plain mad.
Made to Measure Trouble, a report on Marketplace Tuesday night.
The unstoppable Japanese. Their worldwide trading foes just can't keep them down. How Japan competes, tonight on Venture, right after Sunday Report.
Long and lean Garney Henley, the CFL's outstanding player in 1972, was the last of the great two-way players. He played in seven Grey Cup finals, but most remembers an early one, the Fog Bowl.
Well, I can remember all of them, really, but I think the 1962 strikes home a lot. That was a year that I was still going both ways. I can remember not leaving the field, actually. And it was a great day to start with. And then, of course, the fog started rolling in. I think I had a couple touchdowns and one interception that day.
Henley into the 10, the 5, and he's over for a touchdown, Johnny Henley.
Henley's keen mind and overall athletic prowess led him towards a natural post-career direction.
Here at Brock University, I'm coaching the men's basketball team and also the athletic director. So I keep myself active, and I love basketball and always have been. It's been one of my favorite sports.
Garney Henley, 10 times a CFL Conference All-Star.
Did
did I say earlier 1 minute and 39 seconds to kick off? Of course, it's about an hour and 39 minutes. As I say, the fans starting to come in behind me. The music is picking up. The stadium is starting to come to life. Back to Garney Henley. I believe he was the last player to play both ways in a Grey Cup game. Now, the same kind of dedication that Henley brought to the game was evidenced this season by the Western champion Eskimos. From the time they lost the 1986 Grey Cup title, they've been working towards a return chance at the CFL championship. Now, the high points of the Eskimos' road to the 75th Grey Cup game, an itinerary comprised of 13 victories.
And we flip through Edmonton's 87 winning season. The season opener at Commonwealth Stadium, the Eskimos unveil Henry the Gizmo Williams. This, the second of a record-tying two-punt returns for touchdowns in the landslide win over Calgary. The Gizmo scooting through the defense, heading towards a coveted CBC Mellon jacket, later presented by Scott Oak for Gizmo's kick return expertise. Yes, indeed. July 5th now, Hamilton. Damon Allen passed for four touchdowns, runs 40 yards for a fifth. Edmonton survives the shootout 36-33. The Eskimos rebound from two July losses thanks to a Matt Dunigan to Stefan Jones 89-yarder. Edmonton full value, I'll tell you, for a 14-point win at Winnipeg Stadium. Well, in August, Damon Allen contributes to a Brian Kelly record reception. Kelly works his magic for a 54-yard touchdown, equaling Tommy Scott's CFL standard of 88 touchdown receptions. Later that month, home against Ottawa, the running of Allen pays off. He scores from 11 yards out. The Eskimos 5-3 in the season. 5 days later in Regina, the Eskimos are receiving stiff opposition from the host Riders until this punt return by Tommy Richardson's eluding the kicker Baker. Richardson goes all the way for an 88-yard touchdown. The Eskimos explode to triple the score on the Rough Riders. In September in Edmonton, the Eskimos' James Zachary blocks a Toronto field goal attempt. Ron Howard has a clear path to the end zone and 6 points. Edmonton gaining revenge against Toronto, racing to a 42-20 victory. 1 week later against Saskatchewan, Matt Dunigan to Brian Kelly. 38-yarder, easy win for the Eskimos. October arrives and that Dunigan-Kelly combination remains a winning entry. The visiting Ottawa Rough Riders are burned for this 49-yarder. Edmonton wins for the ninth time in 13 tries. A late October matchup with Winnipeg signals a major contribution by the defense. Danny Bass reading Tom Clements perfectly, and he puts 6 points on the board with a 31-yard interception return. The Eskimos close out the regular season with more Kelly heroics, an 18-yard scoring strike from Damon Allen. At home now for the Western semifinal, Jerry Couric capping a perfect 5-for-5 field goal day with his 49-yarder. The Eskimos keep one step ahead of the Stampeders all day, reaching the final with a 30-16 win. Under the dome here at BC Place, Edmonton brings out the long-range artillery. Stefan Jones on the receiving end of a Matt Dunigan 80-yard pass and run play for 6. Jones with 177 yards on 5 receptions, leading Edmonton back here to Vancouver for their second Grey Cup appearance in as many years. Watching those highlights with a great deal of satisfaction, the Eskimos head coach Joe Farragelli. Joe, if I had said to you 6 months ago that you'd be sitting here with me in the Grey Cup coaching one of the teams, I think you would have laughed at me.
No, I wouldn't have laughed if you'd have said the Alouettes, but if you'd have said the Eskimos, I think you're crazy. Yeah.
Joe, you've just left the team. What's the feeling?
Oh, I think they're ready. They're starting to get a little edgy now, and they're dressing slowly, and they're anticipating a tough game, but they're getting ready to play. They know what they have to do and how to do it, and we're all going to get it done in a little while.
There was some suggestion last year that perhaps the Eskimos were too loose 24 hours before the game, and certainly just prior to game time they were too loose. Are you trying to instill some intensity?
I think maybe it was a different feeling, Steve. I think last year they just thought they were going to win, and whoever figured out the odds made them big favorites, and I guess they thought, well, the green and gold will show up and we'll win, and the Ticats embarrassed them and really beat them up badly. So I think that's in the back of their mind. And so it's a different feeling this year. They know being here doesn't ensure a win, but playing like winners will make you a winner.
The Eskimos have not had a great record going into the fourth quarter if they're trailing. How important is it to you very quickly to get a quick start?
Well, I think we'd like to get a quick start. When we get a quick start, we stay loose, and then we're able to do the things we want to do. I think that's the important thing. And it'll also get the crowd quiet and so that we can perform like we did last week.
Joe, congratulations to you and the team on a fine season so far. Good luck today in the Grey Cup.
Thank you very much.
Joe Farragelli, the head coach of the Edmonton Eskimos. Right now, let's go to Brian.
All right, Steve, Grey Cup history is, of course, filled with memorable games affected by wild and unpredictable weather conditions. It's ironic it's a warm, sunny day here in the West Coast, and we're in a dome stadium. Now, the era of the dome stadium, which began with this building 5 years ago, will eventually remove all worries of late November play. We turn today to CBC weather expert Phil Reimer to put past Grey Cup weather memories into proper perspective.
Well, Brian, inside the dome stadium, we really don't have a problem with weather. But that was not always the case in Grey Cup's past. In 1949, it was the first ever Snow Bowl in Toronto. This game played between Montreal and Calgary. In 1950, the Mud Bowl was played in Toronto, the Argonauts and the Bombers. They played it on a field that looked like it was suited for motorboats rather than fullbacks. Nobody drowned. In 1962, it was Winnipeg and Hamilton. It took 2 days to play this one. Kenny Plain threw a pass, and they're still looking for the ball. In 1965, Winnipeg and Hamilton again. This was the Wind Bowl. He kicked it 40 yards, 30 yards straight up, and 10 yards behind. In 1982, it was the Rain Bowl again in Toronto. Edmonton and the Argonauts. That's hard to hold onto that ball when you're facing Niagara Falls. Now, we only have really one major weather problem inside this stadium. As you know, the roof is held up by pushed air. As a result, we've created a vacuum here. So if all the fans were to open all the doors in this stadium when one of the kickers punts, could be the ball would wind up in Regina. Actually, we do have a forecast for the game. We're calling for a slight draft from the southeast at kickoff time. That's for the folks coming through the doors late. The relative humidity, well, that depends on how much beer they sell. And as far as the temperature is concerned, it really depends on the excitement of the game, but probably anywhere from about 18 to 22 degrees. That will probably not be the case next year when we play the Grey Cup game at Lansdowne Park in Ottawa. In fact, the temperature normally at that time of year is about zero, and there's a good chance they'll have some snow on the ground. On the other hand, in 1989, they'll be in that brand new dome stadium in Toronto, and you'll have playing conditions just like this, almost perfect.
All right, here's a fact that our intrepid producer James Huff has come up with. You know, since this building was completed in 1982, they've only needed the cover here at BC Place really for three events. And as I say, it's a sunny and warm afternoon here on the West Coast. We look down on the field. The Eskimos are out on the field preparing for Grey Cup 87. And let's go down and check in once again with Scott Oak. Scott?
All right, Brian, a lot of attention has been paid this week to the kickers in today's game, and rightly so, because Grey Cup's past have often been decided as a result of the talents of the game specialists. I'm talking about the kickers, and names like Sunter, Sweet, and Cutler come to mind, usually men of inner strength and quiet confidence, and that accurately describes Toronto's Lance Chomick.
If there's one department where the Eastern champion Argonauts have an advantage over their Western counterparts, it's in the kicking game. And you know, it's ironic, the Toronto tandem of punter Hank Elisek, the veteran of so many Grey Cups, and placement specialist Lance Chomick are both Edmonton natives.
Hank and myself talk about it quite a bit, and we're proud of the fact we're both from Edmonton, and you know, we've got a few memories going back there ourselves, and we can sit and talk about it. And playing against Edmonton, we do tend to get up for those games probably more so than the other boys, and it's an exciting day for us.
It is often said in football that kickers come from another world. Many are solitary individuals who really exist on a different plane. Chomick, however, makes sure that he is part of the Argonaut team, pitching in whenever he can.
Throughout the normal practice schedule, I get involved. I will throw, you know, the passes, the screen passes to the running backs. I'll get involved with the line drills, being the extra quarterback, being the extra pair of hands that they need, being an extra body they need. And it helps me, you know, keep me from getting too separated from the rest of the team.
During their short time on the playing field, kickers live and die with their immediate successes or failures. But it's tough to figure out what they're really like. Lance Chomick elaborates on Lance Chomick.
I like to see myself at home as being relatively laid back, and as well as at practice, not being too hyper. I find that that was something I was in my rookie year, and that can be detrimental to your kicks.
A calculating player who dreamed of a CFL career since his high school days in Edmonton. Shamik brings a consistency to the game despite the pressures he must face.
Last play of the game, Sunday afternoon, 2 points down, the Argonauts trail. Shamik goes out to kick the winning field goal. You still calm before you do it?
Yeah.
Shamik makes the winning field goal. You're not going to be laid back then.
I don't think so. No, it's a situation. I mean, it's a kicker's dream to play in the dome.
Yeah.
It's not, the artificial turf isn't so great for the other guys, but for kickers, it's fantastic. The ball sits up nice and high. You're always going to have a good plant and a good approach to the ball. And needless to say, you've got the added advantage of no wind factors. It's going to be a good day for kicking anyway.
Shamik blocks out the distractions and zeroes in on his kicking duties. He does so to the point that he is totally oblivious to what he is doing once he has kicked the football.
I really don't know what happens after the kick until such time as I watch the film. And I know they always talk about people using body language to help guide things, and I do it as much as anybody else, yet I'm totally unaware of it. Remember against BC, I kicked a 54-yard field goal, which up to that point in time was my longest. And I kicked the ball, and I don't know what happened afterwards until I watched the film. And after the kick, I got up and I watched it, and while the ball was in the air, I crouched down, and I'm like this, peering through the line, hoping that it's going to go through, and shaking my fist at the ball. And I had no idea I did that, a totally unconscious reaction to the kick.
Well, there is Shamik live this afternoon. I don't know, folks. He's a very relaxed individual. There have to be a few butterflies in that stomach as he prepares for Grey Cup 87. Stay with us. When we come back, we will take a look at the Toronto Argonauts winning season, and we will talk with the Argonauts head coach, Bob Obilovich. You are watching Grey Cup Countdown live from BC Place in Vancouver. Matt Dunnigan, his mobility should be a factor in this game today. The Argos shut down Clements, but Dunnigan is more effective when he runs out of the pocket. Stay with us.
I've grown up in a very close family environment, and at Christmas time, it's a very important family time, and usually at Christmas, I am in a mad panic. I rush around trying to find my presents. I'm always at the last minute. I'm one of those people that leaves it to the last minute, and no matter how hard I plan or prepare for it, I'm always caught unawares by Christmas time. One year, about 2 years ago, I was away on business for about 10 days before Christmas. I had planned to buy presents when I was away, and as my normal planning goes, I was left at the last minute without any presents. So this year I went to Eaton's and found everything I wanted. Shopped for about 4 hours in the afternoon, bought presents for family and friends, my nephews in particular. And what amazed me is I was able to find great selection at just 2 days before Christmas. And this year I'll go back and probably do the same thing.
The eagle has long been a symbol of majesty, power, and freedom. Yet over most of North America, we have shot and poisoned it to the edge of extinction. Now, for many people, the bald eagle has come to symbolize the survival of the wild places of our world. A year in the life of bald eagles on the British Columbia coast. Born on the wind, Wednesday on the nature of things, 8 o'clock, 8:30 in Newfoundland.
In the 50s era of tough running football, Sam Etcheverry introduced an aerial assault which rewrote the record book and revolutionized play. A six-time CFL All-Star, Etcheverry tried the NFL, then returned to coach and eventually become a CFL club president.
When you're fired as a player and you're fired as a coach and you're fired as an executive, it's time to get out.
Etcheverry may have tired of football, but he settled in Canada, embarking on a successful business career.
I'm working with Wood Gundy as a stockbroker. I manage accounts. I buy and sell for them.
Sam the Rifle Etcheverry, Grey Cup record holder, with 508 yards passing in one game.
I
Etcheverry's record-setting performances came in a losing cause in the 1955 Grey Cup. That was the middle year of three consecutive losses by the Alouettes to the original Edmonton Eskimos dynasty team. Well, as Scott mentioned earlier, 1987 really figured to be a rebuilding year for these Toronto Argonauts. A devastating come-from-behind, or come-from-ahead loss, you could say, in last year's playoffs to Hamilton, and an untried trio of quarterbacks did not indicate a championship season in the immediate future, especially not this year. But over the course of the year, the Argonauts matured and far surpassed expectations. And as we flip through Toronto's winning 1987 season, after losing their season opener, the Argonauts were leading Saskatchewan. Fourth quarter, double misfortune strikes. Glenn Suter intercepting John Kangemi's deflected pass. He rambles 55 yards for the touchdown, which put the Rough Riders right back into a game they had trailed by 10 points. However, on the play, Kangemi blindsided by James Curry, and he suffers a neck injury. Jemmy headed for the sidelines. The Argonauts had to settle for only 1 point in a 33-all tie. A couple of weeks later in Hamilton, the Argonauts find the winning combination. Last play of the game. Look at this. Renfro to Tony Johns for the major. The Argonauts celebrate a 3-point victory over Hamilton, their first win of the season in four tries. 5 days later at home, Renfro hooking up with Gil Fenerty for a 7-yarder. The Argonauts beat Calgary by 10. August, in the return match in Calgary, Renfro to Darryl Smith. The Argonauts build a 20-0 lead en route to a third straight victory. For their fourth straight win, Renfro discovers another receiver, Ken Joyner, on the end of this 44-yard fourth quarter game breaker, which extends a narrow lead. The Argonauts win by 3. After struggling through the rest of August, the Argonauts switched tactics in Hamilton. Darnell Clash navigating through traffic, turning a Bernie Ruoff punt into the touchdown. The Argonauts go above 500, beating Hamilton by 6. Shenley Award winner Gil the Thrill Fenerty proving too much for the BC Lions. 60 yards, his second touchdown of the opening half. Toronto begins October on a winning note with a one-sided showing against Vancouver. Danny Barrett guiding the Argo attack in Ottawa. Darryl Smith, 47-yarder to open the second quarter. The Argonauts move on to their 8th win of the year. The defense rallies Toronto at home against Ottawa. Clash intercepting Dillon. Clear sailing to the end zone. 90-yard touchdown ties the game. The Argos went on to win on a Chomic field goal. Kangemi stepping in for Barrett, passing to Jeff Smith on this play. Toronto easily pulls away from Saskatchewan for their fourth victory in October. Last play of the final regular season game. Lance Chomic is good on a personal best 55-yard field goal to give the Argonauts a 2-point win over Winnipeg. And more importantly, confidence heading into the Eastern semifinals. Exhibition Stadium, the thrill sets off on a 56-yard run for the Argonauts as they overwhelm defending Grey Cup champion Hamilton. Fenerty, 150 yards in the ground. The Argonauts with a trip to the final. Winnipeg trailing 3-0, second quarter. Renfro to Darryl Smith. The play good for 48 yards before the Blue Bombers finally corral Smith at the 1-yard line. That sets up Renfro for the keeper. And the Argonauts plunge into a 7-3 lead, never to be headed again. They completely shut down Winnipeg in the second half. 19-3 the final as Bob Obilovich leads his club to the Grey Cup final for the third time in 6 years.
But this appearance by the Argos in the Grey Cup, I would suggest more of a surprise than the other two in the past 6 years. I am with the Argos head coach, Bob Obilovich. Bob, judging not by how you felt over the course of the last couple of weeks, but going back to how you felt at the start of the season about this team, are you surprised to be here today?
Well, I don't know if I'm surprised because, you know, that's what we're all striving for and working for, and, you know, that's our ultimate goal. So I think that the way things happened, the way things fell into place, picking up some people and some key trades and the dispersal draft of Montreal and then finding some good players that were available in the league, all of this just kind of gelled together and came together, and we've become a pretty good football team at the right time of the year.
Conventional wisdom is it takes perhaps as long as 2 seasons for a young defense to gel. Can you explain how it is a defense with 7 changes since the opening game has gelled almost immediately?
Well, it took some time, really. At the beginning of the season, when we made our secondary changes, we probably lost one game because of the inexperience together, and then, you know, we were slow to come along, but from the halfway point on, once we inserted Greg Landry and Dan Sellers into our defense, did I say Greg? I meant Doug if I said Greg. into our defense, it just made us the kind of defense we wanted to be and start giving teams more different looks and our secondary started playing better because we were getting better pressure up front. So we've come together really well for the amount of time we've been together. And with the young team, they're going to get better with experience.
Quickly, Bob, without giving away secrets, can you tell us how you will try and inspire your team, what you'll say to them before they take to the field at BC Place this afternoon?
Well, Scott, to be honest, I'm the kind of coach that prepares during the week for that kind of motivation. And I make the point knowing in the day of the game, I might just say a couple key words or a couple key things to emphasize what I've been trying to drill into them all week. And then it's up to the players to go out there and perform.
Congratulations on being in the Grey Cup, Bob. Best of luck today.
Thank you.
Brian?
All right, Scott, maybe a key word or two like win. Bob Abilovich, of course, will receive serious consideration, and he should, for CFL Coach of the Year honors, the Anna Stukas Trophy, which he won in 1982, the first year he brought the Argonauts to the Grey Cup Final. That, of course, was the year that Hugh Campbell won his fifth straight Grey Cup. Many figured that Campbell should have been Coach of the Year in 1982. Up next, another countdown video hit, the story of struggle, anguish, and heartbreak, all courtesy of Pavarotti.
Kind of music brings a tear to my eye. He's not an opera fan, but he is one of the best pass receivers in CFL history. He's with me now, the Edmonton Eskimos, Brian Kelly. Brian, is there a different feeling in the dressing room this year as opposed to last year?
I don't think so. I don't recall last year's dressing room that clearly. And I'm a person from the belief that the game is such a separate entity and to itself that I've never been able to tell leading into a game if a team's had a good week of practice, whether they're going to play well in the game, or if a team's had a terrible week of practice, whether they'll play well in the game. It's really all comes down to game day and who executes their offense and their defenses.
If the Eskimos are going to execute that offense well, what are some of the early keys we should look for?
Matt Dennegan having time when he drops back to pass, I'd say, is the biggest key in our offense. When Matt has time, our offense can usually move up and down the field, but when we get into trouble is when Matt starts getting sacked.
And if Matt has time, it means that Brian Kelly is going to catch some passes. Good luck to you and the Eskimos.
Thank you very much, Steve.
Brian Kelly of the Edmonton Eskimos. Now let's go to Brian.
All right, Steve Armitage. Brian Kelly may not remember the dressing room last year, but I tell you, he and his teammates remember that football game, the thrashing by Hamilton. That could be a factor here today. Still ahead in our countdown show, more player profiles. We'll take a look at an Argonaut and an Eskimo often in the center of things. You know, we talk about Matt Dennegan. Here's a fella that could really play a key role. That was Damon Allen. From Damon Allen, we look at the Argonaut dressing room. Stay with us. The Grey Cup continues live from BC on CBC.
CBC Television.
You red-headed snippet.
Anne is back, and she's all grown up, leaving her girlhood behind.
Please say yes.
I can't.
Leaving Green Gables for a new life.
I understand you have extraordinary talents. I look forward to observing them.
A two-part movie special begins Sunday, December 6th. Brought to you in part by Petro-Canada. Monday night.
Men are my favorite subject.
He was one of those guys who's only interested in one thing, himself.
Kate and Allie, then Degrassi Junior High.
Catch you later.
Rick's crazy about Caitlin. But what about her?
Why don't you just admit you like him? He's not my type. I'm just helping him, that's all.
Help me? What am I? A project or something?
Degrassi Junior High, Monday night, right after McNally over most stations.
You gave $275,000 to a man you met 8 weeks ago?
Yes.
When a smooth con artist takes a lonely widow for a ride.
This is a fight for justice. This is every man's fight.
I like that.
Street Legal, Best on the Box, Wednesday on CBC Television. The search for Father Jim Carney, a journey that became a manhunt, then a crusade. Tuesday on Man Alive.
Contour chairs, made to measure furniture that's supposed to fit like a glove. But the company has legal problems and a lot of angry customers.
We went from frustration to irritation, then to plain mad.
Made to measure trouble, a report on Marketplace Tuesday night.
The unstoppable Japanese. Their worldwide trading foes just can't keep them down. How Japan competes, tonight on Venture, right after Sunday Report.
The only overtime Grey Cup game in history signaled the arrival of a star. Winnipeg quarterback Kenny Plain turned a broken play into a 19-yard scramble into the record book.
During that two 10-minute overtimes, I was fortunate enough to run off a broken pass play. I think it was 18, 19 yards or something for the winning touchdown, which as an individual was a real highlight for me.
A three-time All-Star in the CFL, Plain has proven versatile in the business field as well.
I've always stayed in Winnipeg. I've made it my home. I've been through a number of occupations and jobs. Right now, I'm in the sales field again. I've continued in that, basically, in marketing, and I'm working with Sharty and Associates in commercial real estate.
Kenny Plain, an all-star in offense and defense with the powerhouse Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
I tell you, that brings back some great memories. It seems every time you look around at Grey Cup time, what, in the late 50s and the early 60s, Kenny Plain and the Bombers were hooking up with the Hamilton Ticats and Bernie Filoni. We'll hear from Bernie later in the show today. Right now, let's check in again with Steve Armitage to introduce to you a present-day battler in the CFL. Steve?
Brian, when you think of the men in the middle of the Edmonton Eskimos over the past, you think of the name of Dan Kepley. Now patrolling the middle for the Eskimos, Danny Bass. Chris Cuthbert has his profile.
Winnipeg first and 10 from the 22-yard line.
Number 30, Dan Bass, is the heart of the Edmonton defense. Ironically, the Eskimos middle linebacker started his CFL career as a Toronto Argonaut.
To be honest, if I weren't, you know, the best, it was my first year and a half in the league and things like that. I wasn't quite sure what to expect in the CFL. Things were run a little bit differently than what you expect in college, you know, from being a college ball player to a pro. Things are just a little bit different. And you know, when I got traded, I guess it was just time to move on.
Dan moved on to Calgary for 2.5 seasons before a trade brought him to Edmonton, where he's become a fixture at middle linebacker.
Each year, the Catholic Social Services help thousands in need.
He's also well-established in the community, doing service work like this for Catholic Social Services.
Because you care, give.
Dan, his wife Karen, and three children, Tracy, Kaylee, and Danny, live in suburban St. Albert year-round.
You know, it's like my eighth year in the league, and for, I think, five of them, we moved back and forth, and we finally decided that with the oldest girl, Tracy, going into school, that we're going to have to settle down because we can't take care of back and forth in our school, and we like Edmonton. The sad thing is, you know, it's a little bit harder for the grandparents to see the kids and stuff, but they can afford it now. They can come up and see us. It's a little bit easier on us, but we like Edmonton. We like St. Albert. It's a nice community, and we're happy to be here, and we're just glad Edmonton accepted us.
Here in Edmonton, the coaching staff and the players are close. It's like a real family, and it wasn't that way in Toronto. And I thought that's the way it was all over. This was a nice surprise in Edmonton.
Despite an impressive eight-year career, Dan has never won the Grey Cup and took last year's loss harder than anyone.
Yeah, I've seen some people in the league get picked for like 10 years, like Tom Frizzani or Roger Aldag, but, you know, they've done so much for the CFL, and they never had a chance to be in the Grey Cup. You know, people talk about money a lot and things like that, but the thing you play for is the Grey Cup ring. I mean, that's something that you always have. You always will cherish that moment, and I don't want to be one of those guys that play 10 years and not have the Grey Cup ring. And to get so close to that, and, you know, to lose it in the Grey Cup, it was just, you know, it was devastating.
But that was last year. Dan has a second chance at winning the CFL's biggest prize.
12-yard line. So the Argos are going to have to settle for a...
While trying to avoid a meeting with Danny Bass more so than anybody else in today's Grey Cup game will be the Argos starting quarterback, Gil Renfro. Gil, you missed the better part of this season because of a knee injury, came back in November wearing a brace. If Danny Bass, Tu Hill and company get pressure on you today, are you mobile enough to get out of the way?
I think I will be mobile enough. If I'm not mobile, I think I had to get rid of the ball a little quicker, that's all.
Earlier, we said that not a lot of the Argos at the start of the season were thinking about getting to this Grey Cup game, given the team was in a rebuilding year. You weren't even thinking about the Grey Cup game, to be sure, because you weren't in Toronto.
Definitely not. I was in Ottawa at the time before the trade, and prior to coming to Ottawa, coming to Toronto, I didn't think of anything about a Grey Cup. I just wanted to win this season in Ottawa.
And how well the trade has worked out for you?
I think it's worked out in my best interest. We're here at the Grey Cup now, and Ottawa is at home enjoying the game on television.
Coach Bob Obilovich has put unwavering faith in you as the Argos starting quarterback. He took Danny Barrett out of that game in Winnipeg in November and put you in for the fourth quarter because he said you would be the player to get the Argos to the Grey Cup. That must mean the world to you, that sort of confidence.
It definitely does that a coach would display that type of confidence in a quarterback, and you don't want to let him down. You want to live up to his expectation, and I try to live up to it.
Gil, there's been no end of talk about the tough Argo defense this year. I'm sure you're here to say that the offense is okay, too.
Definitely so. I think that we've struggled at times, but we've come through in the country. We've done what we had to do in tight situations.
But, of course, you are concerned about that Eskimo defense and the rush that they can get from Stu Hill, Danny Bass, and company.
Definitely so. They have a strong front four, and their linebackers are pretty good with Danny Bass. And we're going to have to be able to control them, move around in the pocket a little bit, and not let them home in on us.
Gil, good luck today. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Brian?
All right, Scott, Gil Renfro, much the same as Edmonton's Matt Dunnigan. And, of course, Damon Allen has the moves and the motions to often be accused of causing a commotion. Madonna supplies the background support for some shifty CFL offensive star.
I got the moves, baby.
That is Madonna set to music, and of course the Canadian Football League videos. Coming up, we'll check in with two of the very best, our game commentators, Don Whitman and Ron Lancaster. Stay with us. We continue live. A look at the Argos dressing room, just over 1 hour to kick off.
Contractor and the do-it-yourselfer will find everything they need at Fauché Lumber in Amherstburg. A large supply of all kinds of lumber and other building products. A neatly displayed hardware area with hundreds of items. Nails by the bulk, buy the exact amount you need. Fauché has one of the county's largest selections of doors and trim in oak, pine, cedar, hemlock, or mahogany. Plan your next project with help from Fauché Lumber, the next best thing to wholesale. 134th Street, from Windsor turn left at General Amherst High School.
Just checking out our large stock of used cars here at Gus Revenberg Pontiac Buick GMC. If you're looking for a previously owned quality vehicle, I suggest that before you buy, you take the time to ride over and check out the Gus Revenberg selection. There's no horse trading here, just exceptionally fine previously owned automobiles.
Lady, you got our attention now.
When you're feeling lonesome inside, and nobody knows the tears you cry. When you're downhearted, disillusioned, all alone.
We love you, Mommy. Are we going to church after?
Sure.
We may be separated or divorced, but we are never separated from the love of God. This Christmas, come to church with those you love.
1949, Eagle Keys came to Canada for his first CFL season and played in Montreal's Grey Cup victory over Calgary in snow-covered Toronto. Keys' greatest fame, though, came on the sidelines. As a CFL coach for 15 years, his teams made four trips to the Grey Cup championship game, winning with Ron Lancaster in 1966 for Saskatchewan.
Well, now I'm working for IPSCO. It used to be known as Interprovincial Steel and Pipe. And I work in the flat roll and hollow structural division, selling as a sales representative.
Edmonton, Saskatchewan, and the BC Lions all benefited from the vision of coaching great Eagle Keys.
Speaking of Eagle Keys in Edmonton, the Eskimos just came out on the field. They were greeted by a chorus of boos here in Vancouver. A couple of members of our CBC crew have connections with Eagle Keys. Ronnie Lancaster was the star of the Rough Rider team, which brought Keys his 1966 CFL title. Don Whitman did play-by-play of that game at Vancouver's Empire Stadium. Don and Ron, as you prepare for this game, I imagine conditions are a little different today than they were back in 66.
They certainly are, Brian. It's a real pleasure to be inside the dome, although, as you have mentioned during countdown, the sun is shining here in Vancouver. Ron Lancaster, what are the emotions of the players on the field right now?
Well, you know, you're at that stage of the season where you want to play the game. You've had a lot of football games to get here, but the week that they've been through is awful tough. The main thing now is, hey, let's get on with this game. It's been building. Let's put the ball on the tee and let's play.
Well, we'll have some in-depth analysis in our pregame show leading up to the actual game, and we're looking forward to describing the entire game for you on CBC television this afternoon. Ron, what type of game will it be? A lot of people think it might be a tough defensive struggle.
Well, I think the one thing you can count on is going to be a very, very physical football game. Both of these defenses can hit, and they love to hit, even the secondary people, which is unusual. It can be high scoring when you think of the Eskimos, but I think the lower the score, the more it favors the Argonauts. I think it's going to be a game in the 20s.
Well, they split their two regular season meetings. The one the Argos won, 23-20, the first time they met at CNE Stadium in Toronto. Let's go now to Scott Oak.
All right, Donna, to be sure, the Eskimo defense is going to have to pay special attention today to Argonaut slot back Darryl Smith, who caught passes for over 1,400 yards this season. He has game-breaking potential. And for Darryl Smith, the CFL season is akin to one long road trip. This is not a picture of domestic bliss. It's a house full of bachelors passing the time until the football season ends. But one of their number is not a bachelor, and as a result, Darryl Smith is under some pressure to take care of his teammates.
Basically, I'm a home type person. I like sitting around. I like relaxing at home, watching a movie, sitting around, playing cards, dominoes, just sitting around. I like going out to movies, but from time to time, I like to go out, go to a club now and then, have a dance. My wife's not here, but she'll kill me if she hears this. I love my wife, you know. I haven't seen any women up here as pretty as she is. I should let her hear this. I need it. This is some good PR for me. I hope she gets a chance to see this.
John Kajemi, the quarterback. Throwing deep for Smith. He's got it.
Darryl Smith is indisputably the best receiver the Argos have had since Terry Greer. Smith caught passes for over 1,400 yards this season, a statistic that in most cities with a pro football team would make his a household name. But strangely enough, Smith played in a degree of obscurity in Toronto.
The other afternoon at the luncheon, I won a Miller Lite Player of the Year, and you know, I was hearing it, a couple of guys at the table, they heard people saying, Darryl, who's he? You know, I never known, wow, who's he? But you know, it does, but that all comes from you know, as far as our attendance is concerned and the way people look upon the CFL.
Smith makes a huge sacrifice to play in the CFL. That, the separation from his wife, Frances, and five-year-old son, Damien, who spend the season at their home in Charleston, West Virginia.
All right. You said she just left?
Being apart from his family makes for all pain right. Like Darryl Smith has never felt right. Before.
Okay, then. Love you, too. Bye-bye. It's not nice to go to bed alone every night, you know, knowing that, you know, your wife is sitting at home and your son, you miss him. You know, I would love to bring him up here, you know, but at the present time, you know, financially it wouldn't be smart, you know, because she's working and she has a good job, but I would like her to, you know, stop working and she wants to enroll, go to law school, and hopefully next year, you know, if things go right financially for me, that I'll be able to bring him up here every night. I call home. I wish I was there. I want to be there. What can I say? What can I do? But everything will work out.
And with me now is part of the cause of Darryl Smith's $400 and $500 a month phone bills, his wife Frances, who is here all the way from Charleston, West Virginia, to watch her husband play in today's Grey Cup game. Frances, does this Grey Cup appearance make the season-long separation from Darryl any more bearable?
Yeah, it makes it a lot more bare. As a matter of fact, when I came, I felt like now I'm finally a part of it because I am away. And when I'm up here, I feel like I'm really into it.
And you and your son being apart from Darryl all season is a big price to pay for him to play in the CFL, but you must think it's worth it.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely worth it because he's really happy. He enjoys playing football, and we enjoy it, too.
But you say you're not going to do it again.
No, I don't want to. I don't. Every Sunday, it's hard for us to get anything done. During the week, you know, we talk on the phone every day, every morning at work, so it's almost like he's there, but he's not.
All right, Frances, enjoy the game today. Thanks for talking to us. We appreciate it.
Okay, thank you.
Let's go back to Brian.
All right, Scott Oak, folks, I mentioned about 5 minutes ago the Eskimos came out to a chorus of boos. As I look down behind me, the Argonauts are on the field taking their pregame warm-ups, and I can tell you the boos were even louder for the Toronto Argonauts. Stay with us. Up next, we're going to have another video which should get you up and off your feet wherever you're looking in this afternoon, and we'll introduce you to some very entertaining people. 51 minutes and counting to kick off for Grey Cup 87. Lots more to come live from Vancouver.
This is an X-ray of a sinus sufferer, and this is Sinutab, specifically formulated to relieve sinus symptoms. Sinus symptoms include congested nasal passages leading to pressure and a painful sinus headache. Sinutab's special formula includes a fast-acting pain reliever and an effective decongestant to relieve sinus congestion. And there is Sinutab ND, which lets you stay alert. Sinutab, a sinus specialist.
Professionals and do-it-yourselfers, Underground Specialties is the place for all your plumbing pumps and drainage supplies. Their experts can help you do that job right the first time. Do it right by providing your home with a good sanitation system. These quality concrete septic tanks have been made by the Lucier family of Underground Specialties for 30 years. Also available, seepage bed supplies and holding tanks, all at competitive prices. See these and the new lightweight polyethylene septic tank at Underground Specialties, 5340 Walker Road, 3 miles south of EC Row.
Hi, friends. Larry here from Trend Toyota. It's demo time. And in addition to the $1,500 minimum trade allowance, Trend Toyota is giving $500 cash back on all 1987 Toyota demos. Come on down to Trend Toyota and take advantage of these fabulous demo savings. $1,500 minimum trade, $500 cash back. That's at Trend Toyota, Tecumseh and Parent. What a place.
Not blessed with great natural ability, Tom Wilkinson possessed an amazing capacity to win during 15 years in the CFL. Remarkably durable, Wilkie never missed a game during 10 years with the Eskimos, leading them to 4 consecutive Grey Cup wins before retiring after the 81 championship. Today, he brings the same drive to his role as a Canadian entrepreneur.
Well, I sell advertising for CHQT Radio. I've done it for 15 years. And I just opened up a video store. Dave Cutler, I figured, you know, I helped him so much in football by stalling on the 10-yard line all the time that I'd help him in business. He and I and a couple other guys have opened a video store in Sherwood Park.
Tom Wilkinson, a 1987 CFL Hall of Fame inductee.
And now the story of another Eskimo with a completely different slant on success. Steve?
About our next profile. He's got the same first name as a Hollywood star, the same last name as a certain CBC commentator. It's the Gizmo. Let's meet him now.
This is the Gizmo who won the hearts of moviegoers in the motion picture Gremlins.
Taken by Henry Williams.
This Gizmo won the hearts of CFL fans in 1987. Henry Williams was a specialty team's gremlin who terrorized opposing teams. It's been the year when Eskimo fans flipped over their own Gizmo.
And this movie come out, the Gremlins, you know, and they had this little thing in there called the Gizmo. And I guess all the football guys went out to see it that night. And the guy that played with Calgary, Stampeders, Lamont Jeff, he gave me the name Gizmo.
William shattered CFL punt return records and was a unanimous all-star selection. But what makes him special is the excitement he generates.
When I hear people cheering Gizmo and hollering for me, you know, and they come to see me play, hey, that pumps me up and I feel good. And when I get in the end zone, I see them standing up. I feel like going up in the stands and just jumping on to everybody.
Even attending daily practices, Gizmo does it with flair.
Football is my number one thing right now. And I mean, I'm not making the big money and all that, but the most important thing that I'm playing and I'm enjoying it, so I'm making the best out of, you know, what I want to do.
Gizmo's wardrobe was enhanced when he was presented with a CBC jacket after his third punt return touchdown for the CFL on CBC. But Henry Williams hasn't always been in the spotlight. In fact, returning punts in the Canadian Football League has been easy compared to the tragedy and hardship of his childhood in Mississippi.
You know, I faced a lot of death, and I really don't know who my mother and father really is because I lost them when I was about 4 or 5 years old. And unfortunate that I was raised by my brother, and he went too long past about 2 years ago. But basically what I've been doing, just asking God to, you know, just to forgive me for whatever I do and try to help me do the best I can do.
Henry is justifiably proud of what he's made of his life and this year's accomplishments, but it's not time to savor that yet.
But it still ain't over yet. I can't enjoy it till this last game, and it's coming up this week. And after that, then I can enjoy myself like I want to. A lot of times I want to let it out, but I have to catch myself, you know? And when it's all over and I have that ring on my finger, then that's when I'm really gonna act a fool.
And now you're looking live at the Gizmo here at BC Place Stadium. He is warming up along with his fellow Edmonton Eskimos, and I think he looks ready. I think he may break one, and they call him the game breaker for good reason. With me now is the star of the TV hit show, Growing Pains, Alan Thicke. Alan, you've got connections right across Canada. Who do you root for in a game like today?
Well, the truth is, you know, I live in L.A. right now, so any game that doesn't involve the Raiders or the Rams is a treat for me, just to get away from them for a little while. They're heartbreakers. I have family in the East and the West. I want to say hello to my dad, who's a big football fan who wanted to be here, but I hear they're having some airline trouble or something. I have mixed loyalties. I just want to see a good, close game. I think it'll be great for Canadian football.
You're dodging the bullet, but I know you've been very busy this week as sort of an unofficial host and worked very hard last night at the big extravaganza party. Is this a labor of love with you?
Well, it is. You know, when your TV show's going well, you get invited to do a lot of things during the course of the year, but to come to the Grey Cup game is wonderful for me. I've been a fan all my life, and CFL has provided many great memories and thrills of my youth, so for me to be able to participate this intimately is very rewarding for me. I'm very excited about it.
Alan, thanks for talking to us. Good luck with the TV show. Hope you enjoy the game.
Thank you. Can't miss.
Okay, now let's go to Brian.
All right, Steve Armitage, while the league has endured its share of tough times in 87, the quality of play was often cause for celebration, sometimes enough to have people dancing in the street. The Sunshine Girls will be dancing here today. The stadium's starting to fill up. We'll return live to Vancouver right after this.
I remember a certain Christmas day. Under the tree, there was a big box, and it was addressed to me. I was kind of impressed by the size of the box because at home, we used to exchange small gifts. So my mother hands me the box, I start unwrapping it, and I see Eaton's written on the cover. Wow. I open up the cover, and I was astonished. I couldn't move. It was beautiful. So my mother comes to me and takes the dress out of the box, and she says, "This is the Cinderella dress you always wanted." It was great. It was gorgeous. It had a white collar. It had a black bow, and it was my first new dress.
Hello.
Hi, friends. Larry here from Trent Toyota. It's demo time. And in addition to the $1,500 minimum trade allowance, Trent Toyota is giving $500 cash back on all 1987 Toyota demos. Come on down to Trent Toyota and take advantage of these fabulous demo savings. $1,500 minimum trade, $500 cash back. That's at Trent Toyota, Tecumseh and Parent. What a place.
Tony, on a sneak. Filoni heading for that line. Touchdown!
Bernie Filoni was Mr. Ticat. Four times an Eastern All-Star with Hamilton, once with Montreal. But his most memorable Grey Cup game was his first as a member of the Edmonton Eskimos.
The first one that I played in when I was an Eskimo. We came down to eastern part of Canada to play the Sam Echeverry and his Montreal Alouette football team. And that game was when Jackie Parker picked up the fumble and ran the length of the field for a touchdown. We won the game by 1 point.
Filoni, a 1961 Shenley winner as a standing player, enjoyed his time spent in Hamilton. And when his playing days were over, he returned to the Steel City to launch his life as a businessman.
I have a construction equipment distribution house across Canada. We are situated in Alberta, Ontario, and Quebec, and we have outlets in other provinces as well. In the construction and materials handling business, hydraulic cranes and so forth. And I'm in the process right now of helping my son Wally launch a new game called Black Beauty Downs, and it'll be on the shelves for Christmas, everyone.
Bernie Filoni, the Grey Cup all-time leader in completions and passing yardage.
Bernie now trying to bring the National Hockey League to Hamilton. During the football season, we have promoted the upcoming games with challenges delivered by players, coaches, and general managers. Now, some like Leo Cahill had great natural style, timing, and wit. Others, well, they've ended up on the bloopers reel, outtakes, which today are going to come back and haunt them.
This is Leo Cahill, GM of the Toronto Argonauts. And Joe Gallant, if you're as good a general manager, don't you dare do that. This is Leo Cahill.
Roy Dewalt, we've got a string of interceptions going, and we're going to keep it going when we get the BC pick. BC place.
Oh.
I'm John Congemi, rookie quarterback for the Toronto Argonauts. Our new look offense hopes to give the Saskatchewan defense a rough ride on Saturday, July 4th on CBC.
Saskatchewan. Juwan, Saskatchewan.
Hi, I'm Ben Zambiazzi of the Hamilton Ticats. Jim Reed, you're...
I'll get it, all right, hold on.
Hi, I'm Nick Hebler. No, we can't do it like that. Should I be mean or nice?
Whatever, be. Why don't you start off?
Hi, I'm Nick Hebler. John Kachemi, he said you're gonna give us a rough ride. You haven't heard of Ride of Pride yet. July 4th, the Sea of the Head of that.
Oh, say something sad.
No, we didn't interview with him.
All right, guys. Don, try not to think.
Shut up, he's filming.
You didn't laugh this time.
Oh, come on, be serious. Be serious.
Come on, dude.
All right, I thought you did everything on one take.
I'll tell you, that was the funniest thing I ever did in my life, Brian. I just, Foster, the guy that works with CBC and myself, we just got into that thing and just laughed for a half hour.
All right, just a few seconds. The general managers are with me, Huey Campbell and Leo Cahill. The last time you guys met, Huey, you were the head coach, winning your fifth straight Grey Cup. This fellow was up in the broadcast booth giving you advice.
Well, you know, I thought he did pretty well in the broadcast booth. But
you're
he
not
did
telling me he should have stayed up there.
Well, kind of wish he had today. No, I think Leo added something to the broadcast booth because he had been on the field, so he gave a little bit of that coach's perspective, which we appreciated. Once in a while, he hammered me, but once in a while, I've hammered him, so it all came out even.
Let me just say this, that I tried to give him advice for years. He never did take my advice, but if I was going to give him some advice today, I'd say, lighten up, Huey.
All right, Huey, it's a different scene from 1 year ago. There's a more optimistic feeling with the Canadian Football League than when we came here last year.
Well, I think so. I think the biggest piece of optimism for myself is the players. The players have come to management saying, we recognize that there's a financial problem and we're willing to share in the burden and to make things right. We know that we can operate a league on the size fans that we have, but we want to market it and improve on that. But even if it stays the same, we want to get the budgets in line with the amount of people that we're drawing in.
All right, thank you both for coming by today. Good luck in the football game coming up. Now let's take a look at a video that not only shows you what football is all about, it shows man's ability to realize his dreams. As we sign off for now, the game is coming right up. Stay with us.
I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams. With those words, Irish poet William Yeats conjured up the hopes and aspirations that bond every father with his son. What father hasn't cherished the dream that his son will become the winner he never was? Time and youth have deserted the man. He must pass the mantle of dreams unfulfilled to his son. Standing on the sidelines of life, the man must lay his dreams at the feet of the next generation and cheer a silent cheer deep inside his soul. The notion is as old as the human race itself, but no more primitive than the gladiatorial excitement of football. This, then, is the perfect arena to play out the dream by playing the game superbly. A young athlete blessed with talent quickly learns that he is set apart from his peers. Only to him will go that large measure of respect and adulation earned by a touchdown. And only a small select group of players exhibiting special skills will go on to seek greater rewards and glory as professional athletes. The odds against success are foreboding. But nothing can deter the aspiring athlete from seeking his place alongside the heroes of the game. Players like Russ Jackson, the greatest ever Canadian quarterback, and George Reed, Saskatchewan's Herculean running back. They are the stuff of legends. They were true champions because they played to win, whether it was in summer sunshine or winter's sea of mud. Professional sport tantalizes the young players with visions of gold and glamour. But in return, it demands a supreme physical and emotional commitment. A few will meet the challenge. Most will fall short. But no one can rob them of their Sunday morning dreams. The same dreams their fathers have passed on to them with sure hands. Coming up, dreams become reality. As CBC presents the 75th Grey Cup. Is CBC Television, best on the box.
Hi, I'm Ron Burgoyne of Bob Pedler Real Estate. Your needs, your wants, your dreams are all important to me. I've been a people person all my life, and I look forward to helping you achieve your desires in real estate. Whether buying or selling, allow me to handle all of the details and to take the worry off your mind. Call me, Ron Burgoyne at Bob Pedler Real Estate. This lion wants to work hard for you.
For over 12 years, Ottawa Sausage and Delicatessen has been pleasing the area's appetites with 86 varieties of cold cuts and smoked meats, all carefully prepared with pride by the owners. They also have 40 different cheeses, both imported and domestic. Don't forget Ottawa's fabulous party trays. Many styles, any size. Order now for the holidays. Ottawa Sausage and Delicatessen, 1320 Walker, next to Pierre's Baguette Bakery. Also 1285 Ottawa and 14301 Tecumseh Road East.
Hi, friends, Larry here at Trent Toyota. Toyota's exciting 88 lineup of cars and trucks are here now. We have a great selection in stock, and with the $1,500 push, pull, and drag sale going on, the savings are fantastic. Don't monkey around. Look at these buys. This 1988 Toyota Tercel Coupe with $1,500 minimum trade-in allowance, only $265 a month. Or this 1988 Toyota Tercel, only $235 a month. Trent Toyota, Tecumseh and Parent, what a place!
Windsor's most complete selection of Oriental carpets is available at Palazzi Carpet. While you're there, make it a point to visit our newly stocked Persian room. With a wide selection of colors and styles at low prices, make it Palazzi Carpet, 3636 Walker Road.
You're watching CBC Television, Windsor 9.
Live from BC Place Stadium, moments from now, the tradition continues. The 75th Grey Cup.
On Argos 51, he kicks a low spiral kick going down to Stukas, who catches on his eight, going to the far side of the field using West. A long lateral pass to West. West is away at the 20, the 25, the 30, 35, the 40, the 45, the 50, and he's out of touch at the Argo 54-yard line.
With the coming of radio, heroes were born. The play of Fritzie Hansen, Kroll, Copeland, Nagurski, enhanced Grey Cup lore.
Maloney is the quarterback. He's going to pass. It's complete. The dagger is going to be dangerous. Look out. And all the way to Hooker.
When CBC Television arrived on the scene, the images were crystallized. In the 50s, the heroes changed to Parker, Echeverry, and Patterson. Beginning of the next decade, the stars were Lancaster, Jackson, Wilkinson, and Clements. The magic continues. The 75th Grey Cup.
CBC Sports presents the 1987 Grey Cup.
Gentlemen,
Eskimos are number one, and we're going to the Great Cup. We're number one on CBC.
Emotions also ran high in Winnipeg as the Argonauts gained a Great Cup berth. The Eskimos arrived in Vancouver Wednesday with James Bell, their number one source of inspiration. The Eskimos hope Matt Dunnigan will be as effective today as he was in victory over BC. They need a similar effort from Rush and Stu Hill, leader of their defense. The Argonauts took a bus ride on Wednesday that 5 months ago they did not think they would make this season. But the CFL's Rookie of the Year, Gil Finnerty, led their offense. And Tank Landry solidified their defense. Landry must lead the Argos again today. Bob Obilovich is counting on his defense. Joe Farragelli relying on his offense. Welcome to the CFL on CBC, your Grey Cup network, coast to coast.
Grey Cup on CBC is brought to you by Carling O'Keefe Breweries, the CFL, it's the game around here. Petro-Canada dealers and agents, our energy is Canada. And by Air Canada, celebrating 50 years of serving Canadians at home and around the world.
Welcome to BC Place in Vancouver. We are just over 25 minutes away from kickoff of the 75th Grey Cup game, best described as a matchup of the Eskimo offense and the Argonaut defense. And we welcome as our game day coaches, too, who to be sure would much rather be coaching their teams in today's game. But as a result of losses last week, Larry Donovan of the BC Lions and Mike Riley of the Winnipeg Blue Bombers settle for the next best thing, and that's to be with us. Mike, you know all about the Argo defense. What advice do you offer the Eskimos today?
Well, I think number one, if they can possibly get the ball down the field, I would have hoped that we could have had that opportunity a little more, but we didn't quite get the momentum going or the field position. Keep good field position. Be willing to take a single point if you have to, and then try to hit them down the field if you can.
Larry, well acquainted you are with the big play Eskimo offense. What would you tell the Argos?
Well, first of all, keep the football. Don't give them the football a lot of times because they have a lot of tools, but also at the same time, if you have to punt that football to the gizmo, that's another part of this game that's going to have a lot of attention today.
All right, Larry Donovan of the BC Lions, Mike Riley of the Bombers are our game day coaches. Right now, let's hear from Don and Ron.
Thank you, Scott. Hi, everybody. There's an old axiom in football that defense wins championships, but Ron, this afternoon, I think the winner will be the team that gets the best quarterbacking. How do you rate the two signal callers?
Well, I think in any football game, let alone a Grey Cup game, you have got to get play from the quarterbacks, and we have Matt Dunnigan and Gilbert Renfro. Now, if you're going to control Dunnigan, you better keep him in the pocket, because if he's allowed to do this, get through the defense and rush upfield, he's going to cause you an awful lot of problems. This is where you're going to find Gilbert Renfro, in the pocket. Now, he says he can run. I don't know about that because of the knee injury. So they are going to know he is in the pocket, and that's where they're going to find him. I think when you talk offensive keys, Brian Kelly is always a key of the Eskimos. It doesn't matter whether you play him in a man-to-man defense or a zone defense or double covering. He will find a way to get open and catch passes. Against the zone last week against the Lions, he goes backside, gets an easy touchdown. When you talk about the Argonauts, Gil Finnerty has got to get the ball in his hands today for the Argonauts to win. He's rushed for over 200 yards in the two playoff games. I think he's going to be a big key for the Argonauts.
We'll give you an opportunity, Ron, to do some in-depth analysis comparing the various positions and giving a check mark to the team that you think might be best in certain categories.
Well, I think the Eskimos have to get the check for the offensive line. Just on experience alone, they've been through a lot together. When you talk the passing game, the best receivers are with the Eskimos. They've got four of them that have played big parts. Running game, although the Eskimos had the biggest offense in the league, I'm giving it to the Argonauts because of penalties 200 yards.
Special teams could also play a key role this afternoon. Punt returners extraordinaire, Darnell Clash and Henry Williams. And the men who will look after the kicking games, Lance Chomick and Hank Olisik for the Argos. Cowrick does it all for the Eskimos. How do you compare these two in the special teams category?
The kickers give the Argonauts a big, big advantage. I think the punt returners are even, but the Argonauts got the kickers.
That takes care of the offense, and Ron Lancaster will be back to look at the defense when the 1987 Grey Cup game coverage continues.
priority post. Canada's largest and most competitive courier network has joined forces with EMS, the world's most extensive courier network. The U.S., Europe, and beyond. It's all the same network. It's all the same consistent, proven reliability. Whether you ship inside Canada or out, priority post, EMS, Canada's world-class courier.
So when did you first start working on this?
Around 1988.
Bell showed us how to improve our information management systems in ways we could afford back then.
That was your first breakthrough?
Bell's ideas let us leap ahead of our competition. With the right connections, you can achieve anything.
So where's your new anti-gravity device?
You're sitting on it.
Tomorrow's successful companies are talking to Bell today.
We're with you where you're going. That's where we've always been. Down every road together and all the towns in between.
When it comes to this town, when it comes to this town, your GM dealer's right here for you. Your GM dealer's right here for you.
We're just under 20 minutes away from kickoff in a game many people feel will be determined by the play of the defensive units. In postseason activity, neither defensive squad yielded an offensive touchdown. Can they continue this trait in this Grey Cup game?
I think this is going to be an excellent defensive battle. And if we look at up front, the Eskimos with a four-man rush have to rely on these four guys, and Stuart Hill's done it for them all year, particularly in the playoffs. Now, if we flip to the other man, Gerald Bayless, he is the key for the Toronto Argonauts. He will line up on the center. If they don't control Gerald Bayless, then Landry, the middle linebacker, is going to have an outstanding game. We look at the two middle linebackers. They play the same position, but they're nowhere near similar in their performance. Danny Bass is the more conventional middle linebacker. Behind the 4-3, you'll find him dropping back in the hook zones, but he controls tackle to tackle, and that's the key of the middle linebacker in the Eskimo scheme. Landry, on the other hand, this is what he likes. He makes things happen. He's all over the field. He's a very emotional football player. He likes to hit people, knock people around. He is the emotional leader of the Toronto Argonauts.
Landry definitely plays with enthusiasm, and he provides that passion to the Argo defense that Joe Farragelli talks about so often. Let's see how you compare these two teams defensively with your checklist.
Okay, we said the 4-3 of the Eskimos, we've got to give them the check mark because they only rush four people. But when you look at the linebackers with Pless, Landry, and Moan, the edge goes to the Argonauts. I believe today the secondary of the Toronto Argonauts, with their bend and don't break attitude and theory, is going to do it. In Indian Tangibles, the Eskimos with James Bell, Coach Farragelli in his year and the loss last year. But I believe the Toronto Argonauts are young, they've played well, and they're on a roll. And you don't measure it.
Well, the way our expert analyst compares these two teams, there doesn't appear to be much between the Argos and the Edmonton Eskimos as they get set for Grey Cup 87 under the dome here at BC Play Stadium. It should be a great football game. We're looking forward to describing it for you on CBC television. Here's Scott.
Well, Don, to be sure, our game day coaches know these Grey Cup finalists as well as anybody. Mike, the message so far seems to be the Argo defense must be dominant. Is it fair to say that the key to handling the Argo defense is somehow to negate the pressure of their tough front seven?
I think that's right. I think if they can move the pocket around a little bit and run the football, you know, really that's, I think, going to be very important for Edmonton. They're very capable. Dunnigan's very mobile, of course, and they are very capable of running the ball, and I think that could take a little bit of pressure off of what the Argos are going to do up front.
Larry, if you're lucky enough to shut down Kelly, Dunnigan, and Stefan Jones, you have to worry about the Eskimos' inside receivers and their running game.
Well, first of all, I think the running game's been really understated here. Their running game 2 weeks ago was a major concern to us. And going into that football game, Dunnigan always a concern, but that running game, they get that going, that pulls the pass rush off.
Okay, gentlemen, you can coach all you want this afternoon and don't have to worry about your players listening to you. Stay with us, and our Grey Cup coverage continues in just a moment.
It's easy to tell a guy who owns a Black & Decker workmate from the guy who doesn't. The guy who doesn't tends to be determined, resourceful, inventive, a master of improvisation. On the other hand, the guy who owns a Black & Decker workmate is none of these. He's just plain smart. Workmate and Workmate accessories from Black & Decker.
Let me see if I understand you correctly. You're going to run pipes all over the country.
Yep.
And they'll carry Mott's Clamato.
Regular and extra spicy, right.
And for this, you need a loan.
Great.
Why Mott's?
What?
Why Mott's Clamato? Why not beer, wine, soft drinks?
Hey, I love it. You guys really think big.
Mott's Clamato first. It's what you rich guys drink.
Good idea, eh?
Harry is just like you and me.
Look at you now.
He got to do something that he's always wanted to do. Harry got to go for a ride in one of the Olympic facilities that we've built for our future generations.
Celebrate it.
The Government of Canada, a proud Olympic partner.
Gee, I wish we could talk. I really need that report.
We could share so much. I wonder what finance is thinking.
At Computerland, we'll have you networking in no time. For the heart of your network, it's Compaq. The Compaq 38620 features large internal storage, compatibility, and a faster processor. For networking, it's Compaq.
Oh, by the way...
You want that report.
How did you know?
We're networking, remember?
Oh, yeah.
When you need answers now, it's Computerland.
And now, football fans, introducing the starting lineups. Voici maintenant la présentation des alignements partants. D'abord, l'unité défensive des champions de l'Est, Argonauts de Toronto. First, the defensive team of the Eastern Division champion, Toronto Argonauts. Le numéro 68, number 68, defensive end, allié défensif, Glenn Kolka. Le numéro 70, number 70, defensive end, allié défensif, Dan Sellars. Le numéro 77, number 77, defensive tackle, Blacker, Rodney Harding. Le numéro 99, number 99, defensive tackle, Blacker, Gerald Bailey. Le numéro 32, number 32, linebacker, secondaire, Willie Bless. Le numéro 39, number 39, linebacker, secondaire, Doug Landry. Le numéro 36, number 36, linebacker, secondaire, Don Moore.
Let's go, let's go.
Le numéro 10, number 10, cornerback, demi-point, Darnell Flash.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Let's go, baby. Let's go.
Le numéro 2, number 2. Quarterback, demi-point, Reggie Pleasant.
Let's go, Reggie!
Let's go, baby! Le numéro 6, number 26, defensive back, demi-défensive, Selwyn Gray.
Go, baby!
Le Le numéro 13, le culture, defensive back, demi défensif, David Daniels. Le numéro 24, le 24, Rover, le maraudeur, Jake Vaughn. Head coach, Pavel Bilovich, and the rest of the Eastern Division champion Toronto Argonauts, l'entraîneur-chef, Pavel Bilovich, et les autres membres de son équipe champion de l'Est, Argonauts de Toronto. Champion Edmonton Eskimos, l'alignement partant en attaque des champions de l'Est, de l'Ouest, les Eskimos d'Edmonton. Here is the starting offensive lineup. Le numéro 70, number 70, wide receiver, Eddie Espacé, Brian Kelly. Le numéro 31, number 31, slot back. Demi-inséré, Rick Howes. Le numéro 63, number 63, tackle, blocker, Hector Potier. Le numéro 62, number 62, guard, le garde, Bill Stevenson. Number 67, center, le centre, Rod Connop. Le numéro 59, number 59, guard, le garde, Léo Blanchard. Le numéro 66, number 66, le Booker, Trevor Bowles. Le numéro 27, number 27, slot back, demi-inséré, Marco Sinker. Le numéro 78, number 78, wide receiver, Eddie Espacé, Stephen Joe. Le numéro 35, number 35, running back, le demi, Chris Skinner.
Official Larry Rohan. Joining the officials at center field are captains Dan Ferroni and Don Moen.
Opening kickoff, Laura May Laird representing the BC Lions.
Bass, Dan Kearns and James Zachary.
She was crowned the other night as Miss Grey Cup 1987. And she will be participating in the official opening kickoff here at BC Play Stadium.
Now, would you like to kick or sleeve or choose an end? Edmonton, which end would you like to kick from? Toronto will receive.
Argonauts will be receiving the Edmonton Eskimos kicking off. And of course, there is no major decision to be made by either team as the weather conditions do not affect the course of the ball game.
The 75th Grey Cup Championship, the CFL Commissioner Douglas H. Mitchell, joined by former Olympian and member of Canada's Sports Hall of Fame, and now Minister of State for Fitness and Amateur Sport, the Honorable Otto Jelinek. Miss Grey Cup for 1987, Laura May Laird, escorted by Sergeant Eric Johnson and Constable Bob Underhill from the Burnaby Detachment of the RCMP.
Not a bad kickoff by the Honorable Otto Jelinek, and he didn't even have the advantage of using a kicking tee. Right now, let's bring in Scott and Steve.
All right, Don, that takes care of most of the pregame business, and we are just about set to go. Steve Armitage joins us on our Grey Cup telecast today. Steve will be covering the sidelines and getting whatever stories happen at the Argo bench. And Steve, I know that you are looking forward, like most people, to the best Grey Cup in years.
Scott, I'm looking forward to a great game. We've got two outstanding offenses led by two very solid quarterbacks in Matt Dunnigan and Gilbert Renfrew. Two good defenses. It'll be interesting to see which team gets the fan support. Both were booed.
Yeah, very discriminating crowd here that might only be happy with the Lions in the Grey Cup. Stay with us. We'll be right back on your Grey Cup network, coast to coast.
It's here. Petro-Canada has launched the Olympic Torch Relay on its remarkable odyssey across Canada. Be there to share the glory as the flame passes through your community. To celebrate this historic event, Petro-Canada has released the latest addition to their Olympic Torch Relay glasses. Each purchase of a glass secures you a lasting memento of the relay and helps build a legacy for our future Olympians.
Share the flame.
Visit your participating Petro-Canada dealer today.
Want to go to university? These Canadian university students are getting a degree, a salary, and that important first job, all funded by the Canadian Armed Forces. Want a degree in the future? We're under recruiting in the Yellow Pages. It's your choice, your future.
It's Match 3 Sweeps, the instant lottery game where you can win up to $10,000 instantly.